Welcome to Good News for Life, presented to you by the International Evangelical Church. As we do each week, we bring you a worship experience using a song, our Kids' Corner, and a sermon on our series on the prodigal son, with a sermon from Steve Bennetson, one of our church elders here at IEC. Let's begin our worship with this call to worship.
The Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing.
Oh, I heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love, the dead of night, and you tell. Thank you.
of the Bible, the prodigal son. This is Jesus.
Heyo!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love. He healed many people from their sickness, performed many miracles like calming storms, and even raised people from the dead.
Wahoo!
Jesus taught everyone about God's love. All kinds of people would come to hear Jesus speak, including tax collectors and people who made bad choices. This made the Pharisees and Jewish leaders mad.
Ah, yuck.
They didn't think that Jesus should be around these kind of people. So Jesus told them this story. A man had two sons. The younger son told his father,
excuse me?
I want my share of your estate now, before you die.
Okay.
So his father agreed and gave his son his inheritance.
Woohoo!
A few days later, this younger son packed all his belongings.
See ya!
And moved to a distant land. And there he wasted all his money in wild living.
Huh?
About the time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land.
Aw, man!
And he began to starve.
Hey, you!
He convinced a local farmer to hire him.
Dinko!
And the man sent him into his fields to feed the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even the food he was feeding the pigs looked good to him. But no one gave him anything. Finally, he said to himself, "At home, even the servants have food enough to spare. And here I'm dying of hunger.
I know.
I will go home to my father and apologize and ask him to take me on as a servant." So he returned home to his father. And while he was still a long way off, his father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son.
Son!
His son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I am no longer worthy of being called your son." But his father said to the servants, "Quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on him. Get a ring for his finger and sandals for his feet, and kill the calf we have been fattening. We must celebrate with a feast, for this son of mine was dead and now has returned to life. He was lost, but now he is found." So the party began.
Yeah!
Meanwhile, the older son was in the fields working. When he returned home, he heard music and dancing in the house.
Huh? Hey, you!
And he asked one of the servants what was going on. "Your brother is back," he was told, "and your father has killed the fattened calf. We are celebrating because of his safe return."
Woohoo! All right! Party time! All right! Yahoo!
The older brother was angry and wouldn't go in. His father came out and begged him.
Ah, oh man!
But he replied, "All these years I've slaved for you and never once refused to do a single thing you told me to. And in all that time, you never gave me even one young goat for a feast with my friends. Yet when this son of yours comes back after wasting your money, you celebrate by giving him a great feast." His father said to him, "Look, dear son, you have always stayed by me, and everything I have is yours. We had to celebrate this happy day, for your brother was dead and has come back to life. He was lost, but now he is found."
Wow.
Well, hello everyone, and welcome again to International Evangelical Church. We are so glad that you have joined us here today, and it is a blessing to be able to still gather. Though we can't gather in person, we can gather virtually like this and still celebrate our God and worship and listen to His Word together. So it is a joy to be with you. My name is Steve. I'm one of the elders here at IEC, and it is a privilege to be able to share God's Word with you this week. And I'm excited today because we are starting a new teaching series that we're going to be doing for the next few weeks. And this series is called Prodigal God. And in the series, we're going to be looking at one of the most beloved stories in the New Testament, the one that most of you know as the Prodigal Son. Now, I'll explain why we're going to call the series Prodigal God rather than Prodigal Son a little bit later in the message. But I love this story. And I love all stories because who doesn't? You know, stories have always captivated us as human beings. All throughout history, you go back and there have been stories and storytellers, and they just have a way of grabbing our attention. From ancient people dwelling in caves, scribbling pictures on the side, up to modern Hollywood today, our minds and our hearts can just be captivated by stories. I know this. I have four young kids at home, and they love to read and to watch stories. And anytime they get a chance to, they love it. And my wife is a very good mom. She always makes sure there are plenty of books in our house for our kids to read. I'll be honest though, a lot of these kids' books are not particularly captivating to me. I just don't get it. Maybe it's because I'm old now, but my kids, man, they just love these books that honestly seem really, really dumb to me though. In fact, I remember a while ago reading a book with my son, Zach. He was very young at the time, and he was just enthralled by this book that we were reading. And let me tell you about it. The book went something like this. It had a picture of an animal, like a kangaroo, and it said the question, does a kangaroo have a mother? And the next page said, yes. Okay, so you flip the page, and that was a picture of an elephant. Does an elephant have a mother? Yes. You flip the page, there's a picture of a donkey. Does a donkey have a mother? You guessed it. Yes. This was the entire book. It went on for like 500 pages, and I kept expecting for some big, exciting climax, some big takeaway at the end, but the last page just said, everything has a mother. And I thought, wow, that is just really exciting. But man, to my son, you would have thought this was Shakespeare. He just loved it and wanted to keep reading it over and over again. So, you know, stories, even when they are dumb, have a way of captivating our hearts. But when a story is really good, it has a way of communicating truth in such a way that it really does grab us in a powerful way. A story has the ability to communicate so much in it, so much truth in it, that it's so much more beneath the surface oftentimes. And that's why I think the Bible is full of so many compelling stories. God loves to use stories. You know, I was thinking about that. God could have just given us a book with a whole series of sort of propositional truths about Himself. He could have said, this is what I am like, this is what I desire for my people, and just written it out in a list. But that's not what He did. He gave us His Word, which tells the incredible story of creation and the nation of Israel and the patriarchs, and then the story of Jesus and His life and His death and His resurrection, and then the apostles and the start of the church. And all of these are these amazing stories that God uses to bring His truth to life. And you know, one of the best storytellers in the whole Bible is Jesus Himself. He loved to tell stories. And one of His favorite types of stories He would use are called parables. Now, parables aren't actually true stories. They're more like anecdotes. They're more like illustrations. Jesus would use them to, rather than just say, again, some propositional truth, He would use a story to bring a truth to life. And Jesus uses all kinds of parables to communicate truth to us in the Bible. And we're going to look at one of those very important parables in this message, again, probably most famously called the Prodigal Son. It's found in Luke chapter 15. If you have a Bible, you can turn there. We're going to be looking at that this morning. Now, some would argue that this parable might be the most profound or theologically rich parable in the whole Bible that Jesus told. I don't know, but I think there's something to that because through this story, Jesus is really doing something really profound. Jesus is actually giving us a whole new way of understanding sin, a whole new way of understanding salvation, and really, He's giving us a completely new way of looking at God Himself. So those are some pretty big topics. And Jesus tackles all of them with this story and does it in an amazing way. Now, when we hear this story, most of the time, because it's been called the prodigal son, our natural thought is to think, well, the main character in the story is the son, right? The rebellious son that runs off. And that is true. He plays an important part in the story, and we can learn a lot from him. We will be doing that next week in particular. But he's actually not the main character in the story. There are three main characters in the story. In fact, when Jesus started this parable, he starts off with a sentence, "There was a man who had two sons." And so there are three characters. There is the man, the father, and then there is the younger son, who's the rebellious one, and there is the elder brother. And they are each very important characters. We're going to learn through them from them throughout this series. But above all, I think what Jesus is doing in this story is communicating to us about God. He's communicating this about the Father. And the Father in the story, who represents God, teaches us some amazing, incredible truths about the real nature of God, and in particular, his heart toward those who sin and rebel against him. And so in these next few weeks, we're going to be trying to really understand these different layers of meaning from this passage that Jesus shares with us. And hopefully through it, we'll come away with a clearer understanding of sin and of salvation, and most importantly, of God. Now, before we dig in and actually read the text of this story, it's helpful to kind of understand the context, because that's actually very significant in this story. This takes place in Luke chapter 15, and the chapter starts off like this. Now, the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Now, just understand that context. Apparently, Jesus is there, and there were two very distinct groups of people that had gathered around him. One group was called the tax collectors and the sinners. And these people sort of represent the outward rebels against God. It's interesting, tax collectors were despised in Jesus' day because they were actually Jewish people, but they were working for the Roman government who was occupying the Jewish land. And so they were viewed as traitors. And they would get wealth off of taking advantage of, off of exploiting their own fellow Jewish brothers and sisters. And so they were hated. They were reviled by the Jewish culture. And so they get lumped in with the general sinner population, the sinners who were the liars and the thieves and the adulterers and the addicts and the cheats and all those people that the world viewed as sinners. They're all kind of lumped together on one side of Jesus over here. You can kind of picture that. And then on the other side over here, it says, are the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. Now, if this group over here were the rule breakers, this group over here are the rule keepers. The Pharisees were the ultra-elite religious people. They took so much pride in following every little letter of the law down to the smallest detail. They even followed laws that weren't in the Bible. They just made them up themselves to show off how righteous and holy they were. And so those people over here really disliked those people over here. And of course, these people disliked these people. So they did not get along. They wanted to keep their distance from one another. They often argued with one another. And now the Pharisees are watching this, and they are just taken aback by what is going on. See, specifically what led to this story that Jesus is going to tell is that the Pharisees are upset because they're over here and they're watching this group over there, and they're saying to themselves, "Can you believe this guy Jesus? He claims to be a rabbi. He claims to be a teacher of the law, to be a good religious person. But look at him. He is hanging out with those sinners. And not only is he spending time with them, he's actually eating with them," which was huge in that culture, in our culture here as well. You would never be seen eating with a person that was considered a sinner. And yet this was the reputation that Jesus had. And so they just could not believe this. And so knowing what was going on here, Jesus decides to respond to them by telling a series of stories that will culminate in the one we're going to look at today. And all of these stories are meant to illustrate something for us. Namely, that God doesn't just tolerate sinners. He actually embraces them and seeks them out for himself. See, all the stories we're going to look at in Luke 15, they all have something in common. They're about something that is lost. And in each one of these stories, the point really isn't so much about the thing that is lost, it's about the attitude of the one who lost them. Now, the first two stories in this chapter are, again, maybe familiar to you. They're much more brief and simple than the story of the prodigal son. But the first story he tells is about the shepherd who has 99 sheep, and yet one wanders off. And it says that the shepherd leaves the 99 to go find that one lost sheep. And he brings him back, and he rejoices because he found that one lost sheep. And then he tells another story about a woman who has 10 silver coins, and yet she's lost one of them someplace in the house. But she doesn't just write it off. It says she spends hours searching the house, turning over every couch cushion, opening up every cabinet, searching for that one last coin until finally she finds it. And she celebrates again because of what she has found. And after each of these two stories, Jesus tells us their meaning. And that is that there is great joy in heaven when that which was lost becomes found. And then after these two short stories, Jesus concludes with one final story, one that sort of expands and really challenges the people. It's really kind of the big punch here that he wanted the Pharisees to really understand and see. The first two were kind of like the hors d'oeuvres, and here comes the main course of his point he's trying to make, because it's much more elaborate, much more drawn out in this one. And so now we've kind of set it all up here. Let's talk a minute, and we're gonna read the story that we'll be unpacking for the next 3 weeks. So again, this is Luke chapter 15, starting in verse 11. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' And so he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, and he set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. And so he went and he hired himself out to the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' And so he got up and he went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. So he ran to his son, and he threw his arms around him and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate. Now meanwhile, the older son was in the field, and when he came near to the house, he heard music and dancing, and so he called to one of the servants and asked him, 'What's going on?' 'Your brother has come home,' he replied, 'and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound.' The older brother became angry and refused to go in, and so his father went out and pleaded with him, but he answered his father, 'Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him?' 'My son,' the father said, 'you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we have to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is now found.'" Now again, in this story, there are three main characters. Again, there's the father and his two sons. In each of these next few weeks, we're going to be looking at one of these characters. But we're starting off today with what I believe is the most important character, who is the father, because he is there to represent God. You see, in this story and the ones previous to it, Jesus is really doing one main thing. He is trying to transform our minds when we think about God. He's trying to give us a whole new way to think about what God is really like. And I think that's so important for us still to this day. He was doing it for the Pharisees back then, but we still need that today. You see, for many of us, the picture of God in this story is very different than the picture of God that maybe we have in our head. Maybe the picture of God we had as we grew up. For many of us, we go through life and God seems distant. He seems sort of far off and aloof from us. He seems like maybe a mysterious figure who used to do a lot of things way back then in the past, but maybe is not so much connected to our lives today. Or maybe you grew up with a view of God where God is angry and unapproachable. He's upset because he's always disappointed in you. And maybe you see God as this sort of stern, demanding, harsh figure. And in general, he's kind of just bummed out at you because you're always messing up. And you always go through life with this sense of, oh, God is just so disappointed with me. A lot of people sort of view God like he's a stern boss at work, walking around the office or walking around the job site, looking, keeping track of everyone, and if someone gets out of line, he smacks them. That's just the view they have of God in their mind. And I think this is exactly the type of God that the Pharisees had in their mind, a God who was very judgmental and unforgiving, just like them. And so what Jesus does is he tells this story to completely turn that understanding of God upside down. He wants us to radically rethink how we understand the nature of God and his attitude toward us. Because here's what we see in the story, that despite our sin and rebellion and failure, God loves us. And more than just loving us, he seeks us out. He desires to be in a relationship with us. Just think about that for a minute. That is a crazy, profound idea. You see, far from being some stern, disappointed, distant, mysterious figure, God knows us personally. He knows all of our failures and weaknesses and mistakes, and he loves us anyway. And he seeks us out. He longs to be in a relationship with us. He goes to incredible lengths to find us who were lost and bring us back home. And this is why I believe the story really shouldn't be known as the prodigal son, but the prodigal God. And this isn't just my idea, by the way. I didn't make that up. There's actually a fantastic book called The Prodigal God by a world-renowned pastor named Tim Keller. I highly recommend it. And he has the same idea in this book, that God is really the one who is prodigal in this story. Now, maybe that sounds weird to you because we've sort of become accustomed to think that prodigal, like the prodigal son, must mean rebellious, must mean sinful, must mean naughty or something like that. But in fact, that's not what the word means. The word prodigal, when you look it up in the dictionary, I promise it, you can Google this later after this service when you're done, all right? But you can look it up. What the word prodigal actually means is extravagant, lavish, reckless, almost wasteful. It's an amazing image there of the extravagant, lavish love of God. And so, yes, in some ways, the rebellious son was extravagant and reckless in a negative sense, in his behavior. He was lavish in his sinful lifestyle. But the truly extravagant one in the story is God. You see, Jesus shows us that this unbelievable, over-the-top, lavish, extravagant, reckless, prodigal love is for us. That's the love that God has for us. And no matter how far you have strayed, no matter how lost you are, God wants you back. His love is so over-the-top for you that he will go to great lengths to bring you back to himself. And so this is really the main message of the story I want us to see today. That whether you understand this or not, you have to understand the radical, extravagant love that God has for you, no matter who you are. So today as you watch this, again, no matter where you come from, no matter what you are in your religious thinking or how sinful or rebellious or rule-keeping or rule-breaking you think you might be, no matter how far you've run, I want you to know that God loves you. And that's not just some nice, you know, preacher talk. That's not some nice, just religious idea to throw out there for like a bumper sticker. It is a powerful truth from God's word that Jesus tells us this story to communicate this to us. Now, even just think about this story again, and think actually about the shorter stories that Jesus tells to lead up to this story. Think about the examples we see of God's extravagant love. Again, some of these stories might seem like, really? Was that the right thing to do? That does seem reckless to go and do that. Think about the story of the shepherd. He's got 99 sheep that are all doing great, and only one out of the 99, 1% has gone off. Now, most people would say, no big deal. I've still got 99% of my sheep. I'll just chalk that one up to a loss. No big deal. But not the shepherd in the story. He leaves those and, in a sense, endangers them because he is so passionately concerned about that one sheep. And he goes and he searches until he finds that sheep. That is a picture of the reckless love of God. And then think about that woman who lost just one coin. Again, she still has 90% of her money. She could have just, no big deal. But she spends all of this time searching eagerly, fervently, because of her extravagant desire. And again, that's meant to show us God's extravagant love for us. And in our story, even though the one son has rebelled and squandered his inheritance, and then the older son comes along and he's selfish and proud, the father looks at both of them and he doesn't say, oh. He says, I love you. I want you. He seeks relationship with each of them. Now again, what I want you to take away from today is hopefully a new appreciation of just how extravagant God's love is for you. And so take a moment here. Just think about this story. Think about all the ways in which the father's love is put on display. That the author here is trying to communicate, that Jesus is trying to show us, there's something really powerful going on here. Think about just some of these examples from the story. First, Jesus uses the image of a parent and a child. And that in and of itself should tell you something about the depths of God's love. Now, I'm a parent. I have 4 kids. And I can tell you, anyone who's a parent can tell you, there is just some unique type of love that a parent has for their child that it really does seem irrational at times. My kids can just drive me crazy, and yet I still just love them. Nothing can ever change it. I might get angry at them. I might have to punish them. But I am still just filled with this deep-seated love for them that I can't even really rationalize. It doesn't even make sense. There is inexplicable power in the love of a parent for a child. You know, several years ago, back in America, there was a horrible tornado that went through a town not far from where we lived. And it was a small town. And these tornadoes can be really dangerous in certain parts of America. And afterwards, I remember there was this news story that came on about a mom who, as the tornado came, she couldn't escape anywhere. And so she threw herself on top of her child. She shielded her own child's body with herself. And in the process, she was deeply injured. She, in fact, lost both of her legs, but she was able to save her child's life. Now, think about that. This woman who threw herself on the body of her child to protect her completely selflessly, she's going to spend the rest of her life disabled in a wheelchair, all so she could save this child. And I bet you anything, if you were to go to her today and say, was it worth it? She would say, of course. You don't even have to think about it. Absolutely, it was worth it. You see, that is the kind of parental love that God has for us. So we see this parent-child imagery. Second, we also see this love and the fact that the father willingly gave up his inheritance to his son while he was still alive. Again, we're going to talk more about this next week, but this is really profound. You see, this would never happen, because for a son to come and ask for his inheritance early, that is the most disrespectful, rude thing that a son could do. And it also puts the father in an incredibly difficult position, because it's not like he can just go write him a check and give him whatever percentage out of his bank account. No, they didn't have bank accounts back then. What they had, all their wealth, was in land and animals. And so if he had to give his son a portion of his estate, that meant he had to sell a portion of his land. And land was everything in that culture. Your animals were everything. And so he's literally having his life ripped away from him. And that's what the son asked for. And the father just says, okay. Again, that shows that there is an extravagant love here on display. Third, when the son squandered the money and came back, how did the father respond to him? The father was eagerly looking out past the gate, longing for the son to come home. And when he did, the father was just overwhelmed with joy. And it says he ran to him. Again, we'll talk about this more, but running was something that respectable men did not do in that culture. That was for children and servants, not the owner of the estate. But the Bible says in an undignified way, that man picked up his robe and he went running for his son and wrapped his arms around him. Again, that is a picture of God's love for us. And then finally, as he embraced him, he didn't just say, okay, son, you come back now, you can go to work. He didn't just say, give him a hug and then say, ah, I'm so disappointed in you. I'll wait till I'm going to give you the longest lecture of your life. You're going to get punished. That wasn't his attitude at all. What did he do? He throws a party. And not just a little party, an amazing, extravagant party. They killed the fattened calf, which is not something you did on an everyday basis. That was something you maybe did a couple times in your lifetime. That was meant to be a giant, big deal feast, like at a wedding. And yet he does this when this son comes home. Are you starting to see the picture of this amazing, prodigal, extravagant love that God has for us? Through all of this imagery, Jesus is saying this: this is how God thinks of you. When you see the Father and how he relates to the Son, that is how God thinks of you. And God will go to extreme, extravagant, prodigal lengths to bring you back home to him. God longs to run to you and to embrace you today as his child. You see, Jesus, again, was trying to completely change the way that people thought about God. They had no idea the extent to which God loved them, and neither do we. And not only loves us, but seeks us out. So, what does all this mean for us? What does this radical, prodigal love of God mean practically for you and me today? Well, let me just wrap up with this. First, if you're watching this today and you are a follower of Jesus, you're a Christian, let me just remind you that this love here is what God has for you. God loves you with a love that is beyond your ability to comprehend. And so when you understand that, just take some time to bask in it and to rest in it and then to respond in worship to God. To say, God, thank you. I can't even believe that you have loved me. And so I'm going to praise you and worship you and try to live my life for you. My hope is that as you think about the power of God's love for you, that it will move you to worship him with more passion, that it will move you to try to live for him more fully and to share that love with others. Now, I think in particular, one of the ways that gratitude comes is when we understand just how undeserved that love is that God has given us. It's one thing, you know, to think, okay, God loves me, but kind of like a parent, like, well, you kind of have to love me, right? But God did not have to love us. We were not lovely. In fact, God loves us despite ourselves. God had every reason not to love us. And yet he chooses to reach out to us. You see, the type of love that God has for us is really rooted in this idea of grace. Grace means undeserved, unmerited favor. That is the love that God has for us. God's love to us is not in response to how good we are. God doesn't look at us and observe our spiritual performance in life and say, okay, yeah, I think I'll love him. I think she's doing pretty good. I think I'll love her. Not at all. God's love is just the opposite. The Bible says that we have nothing, that we are lost and dead and hopeless in our sin, and yet God still chooses to love us. And this love is amazing because God doesn't need to do that. God's love for us is not rooted in any need he has or any desperation that he has. It's not like God is some love-struck teenager who just really wants us to like him. Absolutely not. The Bible says that God is completely satisfied in and of himself. He needs nothing from us. In fact, the book of Acts chapter 17, verse 25 says this, and God is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. God didn't need us. God didn't need to create the world. God didn't need to bring us into the world. God doesn't need us to make him feel good about himself. None of that. And so all this love that he has for us, it is just rooted in his character. It is rooted in his gracious identity. That's a good thing because we've got nothing to offer to him. If our love, if God's love for us was based in our good deeds, then we would all be hopeless because the Bible says that none of us have anything to offer. I love the image there. Remember, the Bible says we're like lost sheep. And sheep, by the way, I hate to break it to you, but they're like the dumbest animals on earth, right? And that's what God compares us to. We're like these lost sheep wandering around, and we're going to die on our own. And yet God chooses to reach out to us. So God's love is rooted in his character. And so as you think about that, as you think about that incredible love that God has for you, again, let that just move you to thank God, to worship God, and have a renewed passion to live for him, to honor him with your life, and to try to share his love with those around you. But there's a second type of person that is maybe watching today. Maybe you're watching today and you're not really sure where you stand with God. Maybe you've grown up religious of some sort. Maybe you know about God from, you know, going to church as a child or watching stuff on TV or whatever, but God is still kind of distant to you. You've never actually entered into a personal relationship with him. You've never called on God and said, "Lord, I'm a sinner. Please forgive me. I put my faith in you and what you did for me on the cross." You've never done that. You sort of just have a vague idea about God. Well, here's what this story means for you. See, I don't want you to hear this story and think, "Oh, whew, good news, God loves me. I guess I'm good. I guess I don't have to worry about all my sin anymore." No, that's not what the story is teaching. You see, everything is taken care of only when you put your faith in God. You see, God's relationship with you is not automatic. God loves you, but you are not by default in a relationship with him. In fact, the Bible says you are by default separated from him. And the reason why is your sin. Now, I don't want to sound mean, but you're a sinner. You know what? So am I. Every human being is a sinner. That is just the reality. It is born into who we are. And the nature of that means that our relationship with God is irreparably broken. We can't fix it ourselves. But here is the good news. Even though we are not automatically in a relationship with God, God wants us. God seeks us out. And he does everything that is needed so that we can be in a relationship with him. The good news of the Bible is that Jesus went to incredible lengths, even dying on the cross, so that we could be in a relationship with God. Listen to the famous words of John chapter 3, verse 16, a verse that hopefully all of you know. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." You see, God loved the world so much that he gave his Son to die for the world. That's how far God was willing to go in order to be in a relationship with us, to send his own Son to die on our behalf. You see, in order for our relationship with God to be healed, that sin that broke our relationship with him, it had to be dealt with. God couldn't just ignore it. You see, God is a holy God. No sin can enter anywhere near his presence. And so we can't approach him with our sin. Our sin has to be wiped away and cleansed. And we can't do that ourselves. Only he could do that. And the way the Bible says that sin has to be dealt with is for it to be punished. Blood has to be shed. But God loves us so much that he didn't want to punish us, and so he punished himself in his Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus was punished in our place. He went to the cross and died the death that we deserve. He took all of the punishment that should have gone to us. It went to him. But notice what it says in the second part of John 3:16. He did all that so that who would ever believe in him would have eternal life. You see, God did all the work. He's loved us, and he sent Jesus to die on the cross for us. The work has been done. God's love has been granted, but it waits to be received. And his love doesn't come automatically. It only comes to those who put their faith and trust in Jesus, who believe in him, who no longer trust in themselves or their good works or their family or anything, but trust in Him alone. So if you want to receive that, if you want to make sure that you are forgiven of your sin, it is not by going to church more. Although going to church is great. When we can all get back together, please come to church. That's great. It's not by giving money. Again, giving money to good places is a really good thing. It's not by helping people. All great things, but that is not what saves you. The Bible says what saves you is when you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ alone. And so let me encourage you, if you are watching today and you've never done that, God has remained sort of a distant figure to you, and again, maybe you know about Him, maybe even wear a picture of Him around your neck, or you got a picture of Him someplace in your house, but you don't really connect with Him on a personal level, let me encourage you today to turn to Him, to say, God, I acknowledge my sin, and that my sin separates from You. And I recognize that You died on the cross, that You were punished in my place, and so I am trusting in You alone for the forgiveness of my sin. And turn to Him today. Because the good news is, when you do that, God is there with open arms. And so, if you're watching here today, again, as a Christian, let me just encourage you, walk out of here and just be filled with joy that God loves you. Because you don't deserve it. I don't deserve it. And so, say, wow, God, thank You. And I praise You, and I worship You, and I want to live for You. And if you're watching today and you've not yet put your faith in Jesus Christ, don't delay. Don't put it off. You can talk to a friend that you know is a follower of Jesus. You can contact us here at International Evangelical Church. We would love to help you do that. But make sure that you turn to Him, because just like that lost son did, when you turn to Him, what are you going to find? Not an angry God saying, tisk, tisk, tisk. You're going to find a God who runs to you with open arms, ready to embrace you. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, God, we are so grateful that You are a perfect heavenly Father. God, that You love us with a perfect love that is beyond our ability even to get our minds around. God, we thank You for that. Lord, I pray for everyone here that is watching this today, God, that their heart would be touched by Your love. I pray for people that maybe have known You for a long time, but they've forgotten the power of Your love. I pray for people that maybe have a difficult relationship with their earthly father, and maybe it's tainted their view of You. God, I just pray that each person watching this would come to a deep understanding of Your love for them. And God, that would cause us as Your children to rejoice and to worship and to live for You. And God, I pray for anyone watching today who doesn't yet know You as their Savior. Maybe they know You in a distant way, or maybe they grew up with You, but they have not really put their faith in You. Lord Jesus, I pray that even today You would draw them to Yourself, that You would open up their eyes, give them faith to have confidence and trust, not in themselves or in their church or in their family or in their religion, but in You alone, Lord Jesus. Would You draw them to Yourself today, we pray. We love You. We thank You for Your extravagant, prodigal love. We give You all the praise. Amen.
Before I spoke a word, You were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, You breathed Your life in me. So, so kind to me. And oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. And oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99, and I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve. Still You give Yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. When I was Your foe, still Your love fought for me. deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Yeah! No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No, no, no. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No, 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 no. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me, yeah. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. And oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99, and I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God, yeah.
Thank you for joining us today. Our prayer is that you've received hope and encouragement for your life from the gospel message in this program. If we can be of any help to you spiritually, please feel free to contact us using our email address at iec@iecinadvis.org. You can also find us on our social media pages and website. But now, as we leave you, receive this benediction.
Thank you, Steve, for your message this morning. Now would you receive this benediction as we conclude our time of worship. And the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore you and make you strong and firm and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. And God's people said, Amen.